down for you, preacher. I'm up here just to remind you that Thursday morning we've got a little mission project to be thankful to the first responders, and that we're taking them pies that Thursday morning. There is a sign-up sheet. We still need about 15 pies and a couple people to deliver. Bring your pie. Now, folks from Louisiana, when you said pie, it was pecan pie, pumpkin pie. Nobody thought of chicken pies in Louisiana. So we're doing dessert pies for the first responders. It's going to be a little confusing because we're having snacks and a dessert supper after the Wednesday evening service. That's separate. You pies for first responders and pie for Wednesday night. Two different things. So if you haven't signed up for to bring a pie, there are a few boxes back there as well. You can take them and bring the box sometime Wednesday afternoon or for the Wednesday evening. But let's be sure that we have enough pies for the first responders on Thursday morning.
Thank you. I appreciate it. We can put that in the dock. Thank you. All right. While we're having the little ones come to set up to sing, are they coming first, Angie? Yes. Let's go get them. And so I'll give you some announcements. First of all, let's see here. Let's have our guests that came with us. Why don't you all stand and I'll introduce you. And if you're here with us for some reason today, come on, stand. And from out of town, in town, yep, visiting with us, yeah. And stay standing. We'll introduce you. Nikki, I'll start up here and then I'll let you take a turn back there, okay? So up here, my parents, Arnold and Darlene Sturm, I wouldn't be here without them, literally. But anyway, and then between them is my one and only sister from Colorado, parents from Wisconsin, sister from Colorado, Pamela Gentry. Thank you. And all right. They came for a wedding yesterday. I don't know if you knew that, but we had a wedding here yesterday. And Bethany and Michael are on their honeymoon. All right, Nikki, back there, you take a turn. Thank you, Doug and Judy, for being here. Okay. And then right up here, Juan and Caitlin Trevino and their little one, for some reason, I can't remember her name. Elise. She's in the nursery. And so this is Caitlin's second time with us. Our first Sunday here, exactly 17 months ago, June 19th of 2016, Caitlin was here with us. And so welcome back, Caitlin. Juan, appreciate you being here. You guys can have a seat. And then we have the Currys. It's Jason and Therese in the back. They've been here three or four times. And next to them is their daughter, Madison, and son, Lucas. And up here by Leah is their daughter, Natalie. All right. No. Did I get that right? Did I get it right? Okay. You may have a seat. All right. Yeah. All right. Yeah, come on. All right, and then over here on your right, my left, is Josh and Virginia Todd, and there Eliza and Silas are downstairs. I think, is Eliza going to be coming up here to sing, or is she in the nursery? Okay, so that would have been a real surprise for everyone if she was singing up here. But anyway, they're from Fayetteville, and next to them, Tom and Jenny McCagg and their son Matthew from Fayetteville. And over here across the aisle is Tim and Joyce Maynard. They were here 2 months ago from Canova, West Virginia. Right, I'm sure you've been there a few times. It's a big place. Thank you. And then over here is, I'll let you take a turn again, baby. You're welcome. Thank you. Appreciate it very much. And left standing is Jim Hartman and Christy and Tristan. And we're grateful. And where is Abby? Is she right? Okay, I was like, they stuck her up here right away. All right, thank you for being here, Hartmans. Appreciate it. Amen. Yeah. Okay, that's a lot of introductions. I hope there will be a quiz in next week's bulletin. All right, so put your name. Anyway, okay, that's enough for now. So you got to make a way or I got to sing with you. Thank you. have another one for us, or is that it for today? That was awesome. Thank you for singing praises to our God. Wonderful. We don't have to teach you how to do that now. Thank you, Dana, for all the work you do with our choir, children's choir. Thank you so much, musicians, for all. I mean, I know it takes work and time to learn more pieces of music. Thanks so much. It's so good of you. All the little ones, I know all of you by name, and I'm so thankful that you're my little brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm thankful that even though, like Darren and I were talking over there while we were singing, that one day it'll dawn on them, their eyes will open, and their hearts will be enlightened if they're not yet, and they'll know what they've been singing about all this time. Amen. So keep standing for just a minute. Ushers, why don't you come and prepare for the offering, and we'll take up an offering. And so let's see here. Yep, very good. Appreciate you brothers doing that every week. A couple announcements for you. First of all, when you have a seat, if you take the time to fill out that connection card, that white card in your bulletin, that'll help me know you. If you're, yeah, you can have a seat. Go ahead. Have at it. Thank you. And the preacher's not horribly long-winded, but I try to give you some breaks and allow you to stand a little bit. But first of all, we need to be in prayer for Mike Passman's mom. She's not well, and Mike pretty well expects her to go home to be with the Lord soon. So we need to be in prayer for his family. In your bulletin, there's a couple of corrections we need to make. On the inside left, it says that the Christmas concert date is December the 7th. We think there are better days to celebrate Christmas than Pearl Harbor Day. That's a misprint, all right? It is the 17th. So if you'll make note of that, December 17th. If you come on the 7th, I think it's a, is that a Tuesday, Friday, Thursday? There won't be a concert that night, but maybe we'll leave the doors unlocked for you. If you're feeling musical, perhaps you could come in and sing to yourself. But there will be no concert. That's the 17th, okay? There will be someone here in the parking lot on the 7th. You just watch. We're going to have a camera set up. There will be someone, Steve, that will be in the parking lot on the 7th. This Wednesday, we have our Thanksgiving service. Now, this week, we're going to have new carpet installed and, I think, new upholstery on the pews. Is that right, Donna? No? One of those. Carpet installed in here. So our Wednesday Thanksgiving service will be in the fellowship hall where it normally is. We'll have a hymn sing and bring a dessert. So I'm not sure we'll be able to ask God to bless that food to our body, but we'll at least enjoy the dessert. And somehow, Lord, make this a carrot on the way down. In any case, you come bring a dessert for the first responders. If you haven't done it by Wednesday, maybe bring something extra for the dessert fellowship. That'll be this Wednesday. And let's see here. Thank you very much for those of you in the Willing Hands Ministry that ministered to folks in rest homes earlier this week. Appreciate almost 100 of you that took part in the parade on Friday night. Cindy, Mike Beasley, thanks so much for your leadership in that event. About 100 of you took part. I appreciate you giving honor to our fallen heroes. Offer thanksgiving to the Lord for about 20 of you that stayed after yesterday and got the sanctuary and the fellowship hall and the Family Life Center cleaned up after the wedding. I really appreciate that. I saw me gaining an hour or two back of my evening at a time. It was fantastic. And so you're appreciated very much. And then musicians and sound folks came in at 7:15 this morning and set up here. This stuff doesn't happen on accident. God is kind. We have three paid staff members and one or two part-time paid staff members. Most of what happens here is done through volunteer work. So we thank God for you. Also, yes, amen. And then we had a birthday or two earlier this week. Can you imagine? And I have asked for permission because these are ladies. But we had two of our sisters in Christ turn 80 this week. Sheba Ledford and Janice Rogers. Isn't that wonderful? 80 years old. Which means they're almost caught up to Joe, who turned 80 in September, was it? So, yeah, so praise the Lord. We've got some awesome, awesome marathoners here for the Lord. Let's see, Angelo, where are you sitting, brother? Angelo, as you know, has been for how many years making birdhouses for fallen heroes, families, and veterans? How many years have you been doing that, brother? Yeah, and I've got one or two in my office. He does a great job. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, Charlotte Eyewitness News will be up here to interview him. And at 6 in the evening, right? He'll be on the news. So you need to watch Charlotte Eyewitness News tomorrow at 6 p.m. And we'll look for our in-house hero, Brother Angelo, as he gets prepared for his interview tomorrow. So they can edit anything out, so just tell them whatever you want. Appreciate you, Angelo. All right, I think I've said just about everything I should say. Yeah. Okay, tonight, 6 o'clock, normal worship service. We'll be bringing a message called Sitting with the Reapers. Also, take a look at my note. We talk about the Smith family. They've been here for a year. Pastor Zach and his family has been here, and we've enjoyed having them. Amen. I bless his name. My great King, all that we can give to you is already yours. Thank you for the praise of the little ones and how much you have made your name famous already this morning. We love you and thank you for all that you have done to earn the glory due your name. And I pray that you'd keep us from hogging any of your glory this morning, either in song or in giving or in worship or preaching or praying. All the glory belongs to you. And when we are in heaven, we will sing of the mighty Christ, the risen Lamb who died to secure those from every kindred, tongue, people, and nation to make your name famous. So we are here today as glad volunteers to make your name famous. I pray that you bless this offering. You do a good job of paying your bills through your people here, Lord. This is your work. We are dependent upon you. We don't browbeat over giving here because there's no need to. You are faithful week in and week out. You give our budget and finance committee reasonable goals and things that we can meet and good finance management through them. And you give our leadership teams here, you give our committees wisdom so that we can properly steward your money and your facilities. So this really is just us demonstrating God's grace. We have received grace, and so now we are gracious in our giving. I pray that you'd arrest our attention now to this act of worship and that you would bless yourself once again through another song and that you would bless yourself through the preaching of your word. Oh God, help us to be spectators this morning of the work of the Holy Spirit in us, through us, and around us for your great name's sake, that all the world may know that there's a God at 3702 16th Street Northeast and Jesus is his son. In whose name we pray, amen.
All right, this morning we're going to learn a new song. So what I'm going to do is have the worship team, they're going to sing the chorus, and then you will follow and sing with them. Miss Susan, if you can put the chorus words, come and behold him. Yes. Okay, so we'll let the worship team lead, and then you'll sing with them after. All right, church, get ready to sing. Lord, that's what we're here to do. We come to worship you in fellowship, in study, in singing praises to your name. And I pray that you are glorified in this place, that you are pleased with the service you see here today. Please go before us and open our understanding as we listen to the teaching of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Mark chapter 11, you may be seated. Mark chapter 11 from the only book God ever wrote, the Bible. Mark chapter number 11, and we'll be taking our reading from the first 10 verses this morning. Phenomenal music, thank you. Mark chapter number 11, we'll begin reading in verse number 1. This is the word of the Lord, please hear it. Now when they drew near Jerusalem to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. Who are they? You don't need to know. Mark didn't tell you. He said to them, go into the village opposite of you. So you're supposed to go into a village. We have the map, I think. Do you still have the map? We still have the two villages, Bethphage and Bethany. Thank you very much. And you notice that Bethany, or Bethphage, is that gray spot over towards the right of the speaker over there. That is Bethphage. And the Lord said, go there, and you will find, as soon as you go there, a colt tied, on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it. So we're going to plan for all of the contingencies here. And he says in verse 3, if anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord has need of it. Okay. Well then, have my colt. The Lord has need of it, and immediately he will send it here. That's some faith, or else Jesus knew something. Verse 4. So they went their way, and they found the colt tied by the door outside on the street. Or as the King James says, where two ways meet on the street, and they loosed it. But some of those who stood there said to them, what are you doing loosing the colt? We find out from the Gospel of Luke that this is a young donkey. They spoke to them just as Jesus had commanded, so they let them go. So they said to him exactly what Jesus told them to say to them in verse number 3. The Lord has need of it. All right, so these two disciples say the Lord has need of it, and they let him go. All right, verse 7. They brought the colt to Jesus and threw their clothes on it and sat on it. He sat on it. Can you see Jesus? He is sitting on an animal that is quite possibly, larger or smaller rather than him. And so Jesus is sat on an animal that is probably smaller than him. Verse 8, many spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down leafy branches from the trees and spread them on the road. I'm distracted right now because I know that I forgot to ask you if you had visitors to introduce. And I'm sorry, but it's too late. I don't want to do an injustice to the Lord now. You'll just have to forgive me. I hope you come back. All right, onward. Verse 9. Then those who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, or the implied is Hosanna in the highest heaven. In fact, you might have a New International Version. It actually says that. Jesus went in Jerusalem and into the temple, and when he'd already looked around at all things, as the hour was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. That is the word of the Lord, and it's perfect. I so thank the Lord for the verses before us. It helps us understand a few things. Like, let me just mention a few things in passing before we get to the heart of the sermon. A few things in passing are, number one, you can see that there is some culture here that we don't have today. For example, if President Trump and his entourage, regardless you like him or not, even if you like the last president, it doesn't matter, it's not the point, stay on track. If you saw the entourage coming, probably no one here would say, "Oh, we're not worthy of your car touching our highways." Or, "Could you get out of the vehicle so we can put our jackets on the seat? Our car is not worthy of your hind end touching it." Strange. I think we'll agree that our culture's moved a little past that. The holy tush doesn't need to be riding on our animal. So you can see that there's some culture here that has come and gone. And then we see that in verse number 10, the kingdom of our father David comes in the name of the Lord. So they're expecting someone. You might remember King David. I mean, King David was a warrior, yes? I mean, he made blood look like sport, right? So when they see Jesus and they think that he is coming with the crowd that he started out with way back chapters ago, and now in verses number 33, 34, they're all going up to Jerusalem. Remember 2 weeks ago we preached on you might be fearing, but you follow while you're afraid. You remember that? Three of you do. Anyone else? All right, so that's middle of verse 32. They were afraid and they still followed. This is powerful stuff. These people have been following Jesus. And remember last week we talked about an episode outside Jericho. Do you remember that? All right, 7. That's better. All right. So far, so good. All right, so I need to keep taking classes. All right. So Jericho is about 20 miles away from Jerusalem. And Jesus has been walking with this crowd for 20 or 30 miles now. The interesting thing about this is that they are still following him. It's very strange. They really do think Jesus is up to something. They're not giving him a king's welcome because they hope something will happen. They're giving him a king's welcome because they're pretty sure something will happen. He's riding an animal. They're calling him the son of David. They're calling him, basically in verse 10, he is coming to continue what David could not continue. And he is going to squash the Romans. And finally, the occupiers will be out of our holy land. And we'll be able to have exactly what we want, a conqueror. And then, I mean, there's so many great things here. We see so many previews here. I need to tell you about some of them. The previews are of the following. Jesus enters in through the gates of Jerusalem. And we see that this is a forecast because Ezekiel 43 says there'll be a day when the eastern gate will be sealed. And if you see any pictures today of the eastern gate in Jerusalem, it is sealed. And we see here that when Jesus comes in through Jerusalem, this is actually a little preview of Jesus coming in through the gates of the city of Jerusalem at the end of time. He will indeed do it. It's in your Bible. Keep reading it. It's wonderful. He will enter in through the gates, and Psalm 24 says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." We could talk for some time about how this is a preview of when Jesus went to hell. Did you know that hell had gates? Matthew 16, 18, the gates of hell will not prevail. Remember that? We know that hell has gates. We know that heaven has gates. We know that when Jesus returned to heaven, that the heavenly Father and welcomed Jesus. Hebrews chapter 1 anointed him with the oil of gladness above his fellows. Gave him a hero's welcome back to heaven. The gates of Jerusalem were opened to Jesus in 30 AD. The gates of hell were crushed by Jesus. It says in Revelation 1:18 that he has the keys of hell and death. Jesus has the keys to Satan's house today. And it's wonderful. And Jesus, at his ascension, goes through heaven's gates on his way back to his throne and is welcomed well. 1 Peter 3, Colossians 1. Psalm 24, Hebrews 1. I wish we had a chance to think about all these scriptures this morning, but I want us to stay focused and see that this is a preview. It is a preview because when the Lord returns the second time, he will not be riding a donkey resembling peace and meekness. He will be riding a white horse. So many of you who are former Marines, you might know, or I'm sorry, Marines, and some of you who are former sailors, you're going to join the Lord's army. For it says in Revelation 19 that the armies of heaven followed him. And get this, you're not only going to join the army, you're going to join the cavalry. Because we're all going to be on white horses, it seems to say. Following the King of Kings and Lord of Lords on a white horse. And he will not allow any voting. He's not a Republican, Democrat. This is a preview that when he comes, he will be well lauded by everybody, and no one will take his glory from him. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And this is also a preview of how when he comes, they won't be waving palm branches. He'll be waving a rod of iron. We're reminded of how those around him who are praying for deliverance, Hosanna, that is a Hebrew, Yashana, it means save now. It's a Hebrew word that they're yelling, Hosanna, and it means save us now. And here, they're praying for deliverance from Rome, but later, when we return with Jesus, we will be not praying for deliverance, but rejoicing in the fact that he will, in fact, conquer his enemies. Our Jesus is not anti-war. It would have been a good thing for him to say so on a number of occasions, like healing a centurion's servant, for example, but he does not. Or saving a centurion by the name of Cornelius, he does not. This is not a picture here that Jesus is anti-war. War is a good thing at the right time by the right person, and Jesus will declare war and will win. Might want to get on his team. It happens through faith in his gospel. No one becomes a saved person because they were born into it. You might as well sleep overnight in the Chick-fil-A parking lot and pray that you wake up as a number 4 extra crispy. Then that you think you can grow up in church and be a Christian. The reality is everyone needs to be converted. Converted to Christ. Some of you need to be converted from baptism to Christianity. You need to be converted from being a good little boy to being a God's child. You need to realize that Jesus doesn't have any grandbabies, only children. So your mama's faith ain't going to do it for you. Daddy being buried behind the church isn't going to cut it for you, son. You better get born again through faith in Jesus. I've always been a Christian. No, you haven't always been a Christian. You've always been a sinner. But thankfully, we can all become Christians. Say, I've never been a sinner. Well, then you'll never be a saint, because Jesus only died for sinners. Only sinners have a Savior. If you're perfect, you don't belong here today. We only have one perfect person that's being honored today. It's Jesus. So you want to be on his team, you better put faith in his work on the cross. We make no apology for that. We'll preach that till the cities are empty. We'll hang out and turn off the lights, and it'll still be Jesus, all Jesus, only Jesus. So this is a wonderful preview, but it's not all that we're talking about. We could talk about life lessons, which are really kind of lame, but that's typically how preachers go with these passages. Like, you know, you should just do what Jesus says. It seems kind of strange. He told two disciples, go off, get a donkey, it'll be waiting on you. And if you see the owner, maybe he'll let you go. But here's what you need to say to him, the Lord of the, and he will let you go if you give him the explanation. Just tell him we'll bring it back when we're done. That seems a little strange. I think all of you would agree. Hey, I need you to go over to Bethlehem right across the river. I need you to find a 1980 Dodge Aspen. And when you find it, it'll be parked in front of the place where you get those amazing Amish donuts off the off that truck, right? Right where you turn a left and you go over to God's country where you can fish for free there on that landing, right? You just stop there, there'll be a 1980 Dodge Aspen. Just decide that whatever's in the trunk you may have. If anyone asks you why, you just tell them, the Lord has need of it, and he'll let you take it. And off we go to get whatever's in the 1980 Dodge Aspen. Hopefully it's not a body. So we understand that sometimes obeying Jesus is a little odd, and we could just let that preach right there and talk about how about returning stuff to people. Jesus did, after all, say in verse number 3, we'll bring it back. Immediately he'll send it here. Somehow, when the Lord is done with the donkey's going to return back to its owner. And so this is a lesson for some of you men to remember to give your tools back to the man from whom you borrow them. So you leave here feeling like you've really had something to help you this week, right? And then we could talk about planning ahead. Maybe Jesus isn't just omniscient. Maybe he's just not all-knowing. Maybe, in fact, he just went to town at some point months ago and said, hey, on such and such a date, I'll be coming up, and two disciples, they're kind of funny looking. One's got a funny mole on his forehead. The other one's got this strange thing growing out of his ear. Just look for them. They're going to borrow your mule. Which mule? The one that has never been ridden. Oh, okay, buddy.